Bank Holiday Monday, 10:45, BBC Two.
It's just not cricket. And it's not just cricket either.
On BBC Two now, with highlights from the opening day of the sixth test, Richie Beno is at the Oval.
Mark Taylor's Australians may have regained the Ashes, but England's priority over the next 5 days at the Oval is to reinforce their self-respect. 3-1 down the series, and with their eyes also on the next one coming up against West Indies in the Caribbean, England have adjusted their fragile batting to accommodate Mark Ramprakash and Mark Butcher. And in the spin bowling department, Phil Tufnell finally gets his chance at the expense of Glamorgan's Robert Croft. Fast bowler Peter Martin also rejoins the team following that nasty injury to Dean Headley. With Rifle and Gillespie both absent, the Australian fast bowling also looks depleted. They turn instead today to Michael Kasperwitz and new cap Sean Young, confident they can keep the pressure on England and deny them the morale-boosting win their opponents desperately need. Welcome the highlights of the opening day's play of this final test match of the series. It's the sixth, and the Australians 3-1 up are full of confidence. Now, Michael Atherton has a big job to do here, and not least of the things he has to do is try to win the toss. He's lost it on each other occasion so far in this summer in the major matches, and Simon Hughes was on hand to see how he goes today.
Michael, at last the coin-spinning coach has worked.
Stewie's lucky 20p.
And what are you going to do?
We're going to have a bat.
Why?
Well, it just looks a good pitch, looks very bare. You know, it's the obvious thing to do.
And obviously you've got a player in the side, Phil Tufnell, who can exploit later rough.
Hopefully we've got to do the first half of the job well first, which is to get a big score on the board over the best part of 2 days.
Bowling-wise, also Peter Martin, a man you know well, he's playing instead of Dean Headley. How's he going to fare?
Dean's not fit. Pete Martin's been bowling very well for Lancashire all season. Bowled at good pace, good outswing, and it's a lucky ground for him. He's had some wickets here in the past.
How much importance do you place on this game, having lost the series?
Well, the series is lost and the Ashes have obviously gone to Australia, but there's still plenty there for us to play for. First of all, pride in everybody's individual performance and the team performance, and also to get back to the basics of Test cricket, which we've put aside for the last couple of games, play the kind of cricket I know we're capable of.
You say you're capable of good cricket. Is there a big gap still, do you think, between Australia and England, the same as maybe 2 years ago?
Well, Australia are a good side. They've played the better cricket over the series, deserve to win the series. But that's in the past. I'm looking at today's game and hoping we can perform well over the next 5 days.
And a personal point of view, a big score on it. What looks a good wicket?
Hopefully it looks a good wicket. Try and get the first job done well.
Thank you. Good luck.
Thank you.
Mark, at last you've lost the toss, but it doesn't seem to matter very much to you whether you bat or bowl. You've got the bowlers to do the job in any situation.
Oh, yes. Well, that's why you've got to play the cricket. You can't let the toss of the coin decide the game. It would have been nice to bat first because, as Michael said, it is a very good wicket. But we've got to get out here and try and knock them over.
You've got a revamped side today. How much is it a problem to key yourself up once you've won the series with new players?
It can be difficult, but sometimes new players can help. The fact that Sean Young is making his test debut and Michael Kasperwitz, who's been in very good form with the ball, particularly over the last month, gets a chance to get back in the side, I think that might help us.
And as far as the game's concerned, are you still confident you can win this one? Just bearing in mind the fact that you have already won the series.
Oh, we're certainly confident we can win. We've won the last three test matches by playing a good positive brand of cricket, and we'll be trying very hard over the next 5 days to do exactly the same.
You've also got Sean Young inside, who is playing in his first test, so coax him through it, I suppose.
Oh, I'm sure he's looking forward to it. He's had the luxury of playing some county cricket over here, which will make him at least familiar with the ground and the crowd over here, so he's got an advantage there. But first test match, I'm sure he'll be a little bit nervous, but I know he's looking forward to it.
And then you've got 5 days to go, and then hopefully a ticker tape welcome back home, presumably.
Oh, yeah, you never know what might happen at home, but we're not worried about that at this stage. We're worried about playing 5 days of good test cricket.
Good luck.
Thanks, Simon.
And those are the two teams named by the skippers, Michael Atherton and Mark Butcher, to open the innings. Alex Stewart goes back to three, then Nasser Hussain, Graham Thorpe, Mark Ramprakash, given another opportunity at this level, Adam Holyoake, with Ben Holyoake left out of the final 11, and Peter Martin, Andrew Carrick, Phil Tufnell and Devon Malcolm. Now the Australians, it's rather a new look side there with Taylor and Elliott and Blewett and the two Waugh's and Ponting looking as they were before. And then suddenly you come to Ian Healy and Sean Young, Shane Warne, Michael Kasperwitz and Glenn McGrath, who's had a superb series to date. So they're the teams will be taking part in this game. And confirmation of the umpires, Lloyd Barker of the West Indies will be the international umpire, Peter Willey, the England umpire. Third umpire is Ken Palmer, and Cammy Smith, that fine opening batsman from the West Indies, will be the match referee. England won the toss and will bat. Well, Michael Atherton has won the toss, and the pitch, well, from a distance, it looked to be an absolute beauty, and certainly Atherton thought so in his interview. Here's Geoffrey Boycott now to tell us what he thinks about it.
This is usually the best cricket pitch of the series. Why? Because it gets a true bounce and a nice bounce that carries to the wicketkeeper and the slip, so the batsmen feel confident about the trueness of the bounce and can play the shots. If we look at it, it doesn't change much over the 5 days, but I just look here on about a spinner's length. We've got quite a few dry cracks already. And if we keep this sunshine for a few days, this lovely dry sunshine, these cracks should open a little bit, and maybe we'll get a little bit of spin later on through the match. There'll be footholds as well, but for about 3 days of the match, I think you'll find it's a belter of a surface for batsmen to play the shots. Bowlers, they'll have a lot of hard work to do. If they get a nick, it should carry to slip quite nicely, but I don't think they'll get too many nicks.
Well, Geoffrey Boycott seems to be in agreement with the two skippers there that it looks an absolute belter of a pitch. There'll probably be something there for the bowlers in the first session. We join now in the second ball of the morning. Glenn McGrath is the bowler. Mark Butcher is taking a strike and no runs have yet been scored. And the first runs. Leg byes. Going over the top, but it certainly defeated the batsman. It's a very, very loud appeal there, but the bounce on this pitch meant he had no chance of getting the LBW.
Well, a little bit of luck, actually. He misread the length, the line, and just the bounce got him out of trouble, really. Well, that was a funny shot. Again, he was caught in two minds as to almost as if he didn't really pick it up. He's muttering to himself, you watch his shapes. Oh, as if it hit him on the body in the end, almost in the tummy. Oh, that's a good shot. That really is a good shot. That is Michael Atherton at his best for me. That was touch cricket, just a lovely little push. That's when he's at his best, I think, when just eases the ball into the gaps. That's out.
Oh dear. Butcher could hardly be more unlucky than that. It was there to be pulled. He did all the right things. Looked as though he was balanced enough for the shot. There was no fieldsman out at mid-wicket or at mid-on. So there's a big gap there. He's still gone, playing onto McGrath, bottom edge, down onto the stumps. Might have been via pad or it might have gone direct on, and it's 18 for one. This is Alex Stewart coming out on his home ground, as indeed was the case with Mark Butcher. Another no ball, and it allows Stewart to get off the bar. Oh, he
got him. What a brilliant delivery. What a magnificent ball. McGrath has probed away and probed away, and he has produced an absolute cracker.
Well, this is why he's a really top-class bowler, because he has the ability to pressure batsmen on that line of off-stump. He bowls in that corridor of off-stump and 3-4 inches outside. He tries to really deny your bad balls. And then every now and again, he'll bowl an absolute beauty that nips back or nips away. He's a cracker of a bowler.
Nasser Hussain is the new batsman. Coming in at 24 for two.
That's a good shot. Just proving how quick this outfield is. When McGrath travelled about 40 yards, put long leg there to try and get round to that. That was just a little gentle flick.
Batsman already having a bit of a problem with the short pitch delivery. Well, that's very good delivery. You see the curve and the spin. Pitch is reasonably dry.
Just dropping short of Ian Healy. And running away for four. Much to the disappointment of the bowler. No! Ball's turning. More than it did at Trent Bridge already. This is the perfect leg break in everything, except it didn't take the outside edge. The seam rotating absolutely perfectly, misses the outside edge by a fraction. Alex Stewart committed to play at it and comprehensively beaten. That's a lovely shot. That's four runs, no doubt about that. Everything in good working order there for Alex Stewart. Oh, beautifully bowled. Beautifully bowled. It's done too much.
Once again, the ball curving a long way and just flicking the pad. It was a good decision by umpire Barker. It was certainly going to miss off stump.
Another leg by, brings up the 50 for England.
Well, he made contact. I'm not sure if it was his very best contact, but the ball runs away over a bone-hard outfield, over the rope for four runs. Nasser Hussain never really has mastered the spin bowling of Shane Warne. In fact, Shane Warne has removed him five times in the series. Good shot. Nasser Hussain been padding away, waiting for a loose ball. That was short and one to be hit. And that's where Hussain does struggle, just about middle of the leg. At Trent Bridge, if you remember, he almost went back to a well-pitched-up ball and got bowled. And there, his feet are absolutely nowhere. Oh, dear, dear, dear.
Well, a slice of luck from England's point of view. Nasser not being terribly positive there. I suppose you could say that he did try and play the ball down, but it might well have been just at catching height.
Big shout there. No attempt to play it with a bat. That wasn't a bad call at all. Worth making the point.
Well, it's certainly worth asking the question, and this one quite close. The umpire would have to be guessing there, and umpire Lloyd Barker, standing in this one and only test match, views in favour of the batsman.
Oh, wonderfully bowled, wonderfully bowled. For that lovely flight and the sharp dip and the spin, it could well be a stock ball for a wrist spinner, but he gets the drift in too, almost sends Alex Stewart the wrong way. Oh, well bowled. Well, that's Kasperwitz at his best. A little bit off the seam there. And the bat goes searching for it. Oh, another one. Absolute Jaffa. And just a small stride with the front foot, a sort of walking shot. Back and across, and then just going nowhere with the front foot. Front foot locked in there, inside the crease.
That's nicely played. He waited on that. Very important to be able to play strokes on the onside in that fashion off Warne. 3-2 Hussain. Oh, has he got an edge? Must have done, I would think. Peter Willey as the umpire. That looked, from where we're sitting, to be fairly plumb.
Certainly looked plumb, but the way that Nasser Hussain came up and had a look at his bat suggests that he did get an edge on it.
It's an eventful few minutes.
Michael Kasperwitz has only had a short test career. He hasn't had much luck so far in that test career.
Oh, beautiful. That was so well bowled. The swing was there just as the batsman started to play a shot.
That was late movement from Kasperwitz, which is what the bowler's looking for.
Tasmanian cricketer. Quite a useful one too. He's had four very good summers in Australia. Didn't actually force his way into this side. Couldn't quite make the touring team, but has been playing with Gloucestershire and is called up because Rifle and Gillespie are unavailable for this match. Beautifully bowled.
Well, that's the stock delivery for Sean Young. A little bit of outswing. He's done well to get outswing from the pavilion end.
First loose one is bowled for a while. Alex Stewart took full advantage of it.
Well, that's when bowling can be a cruel game. You beat the batsman, get nothing for it, suddenly just make a slight error in line and length, and bang, it gets punished. Who'd want to be a bowler?
Can't answer that question.
Let's a ploy that a lot of medium pacers would use, particularly medium pace outswing bowlers. Every now and again, throw one up very wide, hope that it just swings a little bit.
That's over the top as well. Sean Young is only medium pace, perhaps a fraction sharper than that, but wouldn't actually class him as fast medium. And he's posing all sorts of problems out there.
That's pretty close, and that's out. Glenn McGrath with his first delivery after lunch. Takes the wicket of Alex Stewart. Caught on the crease somewhat, but that ball came back into him.
Well, concentration has always been a problem for Alec. It's not been about talent or ability. He's such a good timer of the ball, got a big range of shots. Straight after lunch, just nips back, missed it. I mean, he didn't nip back that much, just enough. And I don't think it was that difficult for Peter Willey to give him out, because I think it was out. New batsman is Graham Thorpe.
Graham Thorpe.
Inside edge. And Hussain looking for two. Even though he slipped at the non-striker's end, he still had time to come back for it. And England reached the 100. They're 101 now. For three. Very, very close. Very nicely bowled too. Just a bit of a movement away from the left-hander. Just too much. Well, that was very, very close, but for the inside edge. Hussain does get onto off stump as a basic method. He likes to play the ball from there to judge where his off stump is.
Shot.
Good shot and a good stop too. Ricky Ponting. Got half a hand on that. It was certainly enough to take the pace off it and stop the ball going for four. Very athletic piece of work.
Thick outside edge, and that races away down to the pavilion. The hollow cheers all around. Yep, four runs.
Thorpe has pulled McGrath probably better than any other Englishman in this series.
McGrath bowling over the wicket now to Thorpe. Doesn't enjoy that, but he did make the decision to move from round the wicket, and he's trying to slant it across with quite an aggressive cordon of close catches there. Oh, it's in the air, and Steve Waugh went for it. Shane Warne collects it. McGrath walks down the wicket and stands right next to the batsman. Well, he's always keen to pass the time of day with a batsman who plays a miscue.
Certainly hit something first. It's a matter of what the umpire thought it was. Steve Waugh was trying to catch it so that the umpire had to make a decision.
In the air, caught. It's gone. What a strange way to get out to a fast bowler, I must say. Again, he was well across, all the emphasis on across and not forward, and so the weight not truly on the front foot. And so Nasser Hussain disappointingly goes now, splendidly caught by Matthew Elliott at mid-on off McGrath. McGrath's fourth wicket for 35. It's 128 for four. Mark Rampakrash is the next batsman, comes into a great cheer. Clearly, quite a few Middlesex fans across the Vauxhall Bridge today. Oh, look at that. McGrath. Thorpe at 27. Rampakrash on strike. Oh. Off the mark straight away. And now a cheer of relief among the crowd. Two runs to Mark Rampakrash. I think Glenn McGrath's fed up with seeing the ball squirting off Thorpe's bat, so he goes round the wicket this time. And over the stumps go. Well, there you are. It bowled over the wicket and across him. Then round the wicket and at him, at his stumps. And that's the fifth wicket taken by Glenn McGrath out of five. 131 for five.
Thorpe was so keen there to get across and cover off stump that he just left leg stump, just gave McGrath a sighter, and that was all he needed. Another fine performance from Glenn McGrath.
This is Adam Holyoake, who may well be the one to put the bat to the ball. Casey's full of threatening gestures as he walks to the middle. Almost arrives like the knight in shining armour. Another big shout. And still Mr. Willie is unmoved. Can you get? Out goes Holyoake. Extraordinary bit of test cricket, that. The deception, we must believe, was in the hand. A lot of it, I guess, is in the mind.
Well, a case of the batsman thinking it was a leg break, but it was actually the top spinner just skidding straight on. And I'm not sure why batsmen are letting balls go, and we've seen it happen a few times already in this test match, letting balls go that are basically pitched on the stumps.
Well, that's out. That is out. Another one down. McGrath has picked up Rampakrash from a rather, well, I suppose feeble would fit the bill, rather a feeble push away on the onside. McGrath has got him with a bit of extra pace and bounce.
You've got to expect balls up around, you know, sort of rib area in test match cricket, and especially when you first come in.
Now then, Peter Martin's the batsman. A good stroke. They should get three for that if they're prepared to run hard enough.
Out. Nick, no.
It's either inside edge or off stump. It hit one of the two. What about off stump?
Well, I think that's finished up as a really good decision.
Catch! In the air, but safe. That'll put McGrath in a good humour. Put the batsman in a good humour. Not too sure about Shane Warne. It's what happens when the ball is spinning when it's hit square of the wicket.
Catch! Yeah!
Well, there's two noises there. It's just a question of what the two noises were.
Just nip back, hit him on the thigh.
Might have clipped his pad with the bat afterwards.
Shot. Big hit.
Six more. Peter Martin just helping that on its way. That's probably about the shortest boundary here at the Oval. That's it. 20 and out. Well, it's certainly Glenn McGrath's day, no doubt about that. Peter Martin showing brief resistance. It was a bright and breezy 20. Coming off just 19 deliveries.
Well, you could say he was a little bit unlucky there. I think he saw the Yorker, was playing down on it, and it just swings a touch at the last moment and gets the inside edge onto the stumps.
A little tough now. Striding, there we say to the crease. Four runs, good shot. Glenn McGrath really has been the outstanding bowler of this Australian side. That's a great shot again. Four runs from the moment it left the bat. Overpitched by Michael Kasprowitz.
Well, a slight shake of the head, but the thing that happened here was that he gave Andy Caddick some width.
That's on its way down to a different boundary. Guided down towards third man. Four more runs. Question, that's out. Well, final ball of the over. Little thin tickle onto the pad. Nice simple catch for Greg Blewett at short leg.
This ball going straight through, and there you can see the faint little edge onto pad. And well, when you want the ball to go into the ground, sadly it goes straight up into the air.
Away, one bounce, four. Now that's one of the longer boundaries. They're entitled to smile too. That's out. Dismal end to a dismal innings for England. All out 180. Devon Malcolm goes to his first delivery.
There's Glenn McGrath. He's been the hero of the day for Australia. He's been the hero of Australia for most of the series.
Yes, it was a superb performance from Glenn McGrath, just almost matching the one at Lords where he took 8 wickets, 180 all out. Top score there, Alex Stewart, 36, didn't play badly. Hussain looked a bit at odds with himself and with the Australian bowlers today. And Thorpe, 27. They all got a bit of a start, but it was left to the tail-enders, Caddick and Martin, to add a touch of respectability to the whole thing. Now, the bowling figures for the Australians, they're quite outstanding in two areas. McGrath, 21 overs, 4 maidens, 7 for 76. I thought he bowled quite beautifully. You could count on the fingers of one hand the bad balls he bowled in all those 21 overs. Kasprowitz was unlucky, 1 for 56 for him, and Young, none for 8. And I thought Warne bowled extremely well, 17 overs, 8 maidens, and 2 for 32, and I thought his best bowling of the summer was in the first innings at Trent Bridge, and this here today with the 2 for 32 for him. We're going to join the Australian innings now. It's the first ball. Devon Malcolm is the bowler. He's coming in from the Vauxhall end, and Matthew Elliott is taking a strike. Well, there's a start. Quite a good shot. It was only a loosener from Devon Malcolm. Willie has said no. Umpire Malcolm is raising an eyebrow.
Well, already the game's just one day old, and we've seen quite a few batsmen letting balls go that are very, very close to the stumps. One, in fact, Adam Holyoake, letting a ball go that hit middle stump.
That's a pretty good one, and we've seen that shot before from Mark Taylor.
He started to try and go after deliveries that are moving off the seam, whereas before he used to play, and if it moved off the seam, he didn't try and catch up with the ball.
Well, Markham's come around the wicket now to change the angle, and additionally, I suspect, because he was bowling so wide of the off stump from over the wicket, he's certainly falling away quite sharply again in his delivery stride. Well, that's a better shot. He almost played that in slightly lazy fashion. Well, so far, three boundaries in this over. Two from short deliveries, and that one, well, I suppose it wasn't quite a half volley on leg stump, but it wasn't far away from being that.
Slightly uppish, very safe, on its way now to the cover boundary. Four runs to Mark Taylor. Australia racing on. Great shot.
Oh dear, it's one of his favourite shots. You drop it slightly short, he's looking for it. Terrific. He bowled straight at him and then he flighted that just a little bit wider, tempted Matthew Elliott to go for it, and it spun back. Top class wicket by Phil Tufnell. But that was clever bowling. Used the footholds, and he's got an opportunity at some stage to bowl at Taylor just the same when he gets him down that end. Out. Yeah, he sort of tried to drive it and he scooped it straight up to the batting pad man.
Well, it's Adam Holyoake in unfamiliar territory there. He's normally in the slips. Give him credit, he's kept in position. I dare say he's actually felt it hit him as much as anything else. And Phil Tufnell now has two wickets after just seven deliveries.
It's a very nice cut in the end. It was just about off stump.
Oh. That's a very good delivery. The spinner is beating the batsman in a forward defensive stroke. He knows that he's got his length right.
Well, the rain came down at 74 for two. The players went off the field. There was a bit of bad light as well, although the rain was the real reason for them going off. They added another three runs to take it along to 77 for two, then went off again. And unfortunately for the spectators who'd paid their money at the gate, they never came back again. Good start for the Australians with the opening partnership, Elliott and Taylor. And Taylor batted very well for his 38. Then Blewett and Waugh, Mark Waugh, were intent mainly on survival, 10 and 13 respectively, 77 for two. And the bowling figures for England, Tufnell quite outstanding. I thought he bowled really well. The big mystery is, why is this his first test match in this six test series? So the situation at the end of the first day of this Cornhill test match,
The Australians 103 runs behind, and the reason they're in such a good position is the bowling of Glenn McGrath, and he talked after the game with Simon Hughes.
Glenn, I suppose we were a bit naive in a way to assume the Australians weren't going to be hyped up for this game.
Well, if you look at the past two series where we've lost the last test of each series, it's you know, there's been a few things written up about it, and I think myself and the guys were pretty keen to get out there and show that we're not, well, as soon as the series won, we don't sort of slacken off. And, you know, we're looking forward to going home, and, you know, sooner we can wrap up this. Well, that was our the way we looked at it, the sooner we can go home.
Was it as good a wicket to bowl on as you made it look?
Well, I thought it was pretty slow to start with in the morning. There doesn't seem to be too much grass on there. And, you know, the ball went through okay, but not that good. And you saw Warnie get quite a bit of turn for a first day test wicket. So, you know, I just concentrated on putting enough balls on the right spot. Probably just bowled a little bit shorter than most English conditions, and it seemed to work.
You make it sound so simple, and yet we have such problems, England batsmen, playing you. It's not as simple as that really, is it?
Well, I tend to think the simpler you can keep something, the better you are at it. So, you know, I just run in and, you know, try to bowl good line and length, mix it up a bit, try to, you know, work out the batsman a little bit, and take it from there. And it's worked quite well.
You seem to have a jinx over Mike Atherton, certainly. You seem to have worked out his game. Was that a plan, the way you got him out today?
Yeah, I was hoping to get it to come back off the wicket and take the inside edge. But no, I think when I'm bowling to Athers, just bowl good line and length with occasional short ball in, and it, you know, just tie him up, cut down the scoring, and, you know, hopefully a guy at the other end's bowling well to build up the pressure, and, you know, it's worked so far.
That certainly seems to be the difference between your bowling and, say, some of the England seamers' bowling, is that you dry up the scoring.
Yeah, well, you know, when I'm bowling well, I tend to, you know, hit a good line and length, and it's hard to score. And if you've got someone like Warnie at the other end who's doing exactly the same thing, then, you know, the pressure just builds, and when you're not ticking over the scoreboard, it, you know, there's quite a bit of pressure there, and it sort of builds up.
How about the wicket of Graham Thorpe, who played you so well at Trent Bridge? Was that part of a plan, bowling round the wicket and bowling him round his legs?
No, not really. I was supposed to start a bit more outside off stump, but it drifted on a leg, and luckily got through and hit leg stump. So it was, you know, sometimes you get a bit of luck when you're out there bowling, as long as you put enough in the right spot.
Mike Atherton's compared your bowling facing it to facing Kirtley Ambrose. I suppose that's quite a high accolade.
I tend to think it is. You know, I rate Kirtley quite highly, you know, up there with the best, if not the best. And it's funny to picture myself up there alongside those guys, but yeah, away it goes, I guess.
A very modest cricketer and a very, very good one, improving all the time, Glenn McGrath, and a great performance from him today. Now, with their ideas on what happened today and what might be happening tomorrow and for the other days of the match, here's Ian Chappell, and with him, Geoffrey Boycott.
The day promised much, with Michael Atherton winning the toss for the first time and looking to bat, and then getting to lunch at 97 for two. There was great hope that England would get through the day 300 runs. But same old faults, same situation of just falling away with some poor cricket straight after lunch, Ian. What do you make of it?
Yes, I think it was probably even worse than Trent Bridge. Good pitch and depleted Australian attack, although they still had their two main forces there. But if Michael Atherton was thinking about resigning the captaincy before this test match, I think he would have known after the England innings that his thinking was on the right lines. Must have been very depressing for Atherton, I think. And then to follow it up with the bad bowling from the fast bowlers, that would have just made his day very gloomy.
Yeah, because the point is, as captain, you want to be able to get something out of your players. When you can't get a response, it's not just your fault, but the thing's just not going right,
yeah.
Is it?
Yeah. I guess the one good note was the way that Phil Tufnell bowled. Yeah. I was delighted to see him bowling in a very attacking vein. I've seen him bowl a bit negatively lately, but I thought he flighted the ball well. That was a beauty that got rid of Matthew Elliott.
Yeah, it was. A sucker ball. Really naive batting from him, but it was great for Tuffers. He's the best hope for England tomorrow, isn't he, Tufnell? Quite a bit of spin. The seamers have got a ball tight, and they've just got to hope for some early wickets, haven't they, England?
Got to get some wickets. Well, they've got to get them regularly and often.
Justifiable applause there from Ian Chappell and Geoffrey Boycott for the work done by Glenn McGrath and Shane Warne, and also Phil Tufnell, who may well have a hand to play in things tomorrow. Now then, we're back with you tomorrow BBC One at 10:50 a.m. the second day of the sixth Cornhill Test match. And we leave you from the Oval with Glenn McGrath, great performer and a terrific performance from him here at the Oval today.